How many of y'all love it more than anything? Oh, come on, don't play with me this evening. How many of you love it more than anything? Glory be to God. Woo! How many of you know he deserves your love? He deserves your love. The Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Glory be to God. And I don't know about you, but I love you, Jesus. I worship
and adore you. Just want to tell you.
Yeah.
Lord, I
can we do a little neo soul with it, Chris? Come on. Come on, y'all.
I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you.
Tell your neighbor, rock with me. Come on. Rock with us this evening and say, I love you, Jesus. Let's say right there. Listen, I want to, before we bring our next speaker, amen, I want every preacher, pastor, bishop, archbishop, whatever you are this evening, I want you to stand, amen, amen, all of the ministers in the house, come on, come on, hallelujah, hallelujah. Ladies, I want you to turn around and look. Glory be to God. These are your brothers and sisters in the ministry. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And how many of you know that we don't fight each other? We don't compete against each other. Ah, but we got a good team, y'all. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Listen, our next speaker this evening, I've had the honor of knowing this young lady for a very, very long time. Very long time. We met in the great metropolis of Satin, Texas, years ago. Amen. Amen. She was a young lady. And, amen. And I was a young man. Amen. But God did some great things. I've had the privilege of seeing God bring her and elevate her. And she has been, over the years, even at the Cedar Grove Church and even now at Abundant Love Fellowship, she has been one faithful servant of God. And I know that God rewards faithfulness. And so God has elevated her, glory be to God, called her into the kingdom for such a time as this to declare his word. My brothers and sisters, I want to present to you this evening, Sister Yolanda Minor.
Seemed to fall asleep. There was so much on my mind. I was searching for time to pray, Lord, help me, please. He said, you don't have to cry. I'll supply all your needs. Soon as I stopped worrying how the story ends, I let go and I let God.
Have your way, God.
Let God have his way. That's when start happening. I stop looking at back then. Just let go. Let God. Let go. And let
God.
Let go. Let God. Let go. And let God have his way.
You may all be seated. First, giving honor to God, thanking him for his mercy and his grace and his delivering power. Thanking him for this opportunity that I dare not take lightly. And then I want to thank Pastor Ross, the anchor of this church. He shared many, many stories with us about his time in the ministry. And some people might not have even wanted to give us those examples or those stories, are those personal testimonies, but they really helped us to see that we are human. Even though we have been called by God, people may try to put us on a level, we're still people. We're still human. And then I want to thank First Lady. She has taught us a lot. how to be humble, how to pray, how to not give up, to move forward. She is a good example of how we all should be, how we all should live, and how we all should treat one another. And then I want to thank all of the ministers of Abundant Love Fellowship. A special thanks to MIT 2, we're one. Thanking them for their support. They would come out and hear us and give us feedback. And it was such a blessing for us to receive the pouring in that they did for our spirits. They helped us to grow. They helped us to mature. They helped us to get over the fear. And they're good examples of what God will do if you just let go. I want to say thank you to my husband, who is my best friend. He's been my rock. He's been my protector. He is ice water. He is my ice water. That's what he is. I thank God for my children, for my grandbabies. My son couldn't be here today, and this is a bittersweet moment for me because he's away in basic training for the Air Force. You talk about an inspiration. Bubba is truly an inspiration. And last but not least, my mom. My mom is my rock. She taught me how to be strong. She taught me how to be patient. She taught me how to be loving and kind, even when the world was not. She taught me how to study. She taught me how to go to church and listen to the word. She took me to Sunday school, BTU, any other service she took me to. I was there. My kids were there. They can testify. But I thank God for a praying mother, for a mother that stood strong and firm in the belief of God in the time of trouble in her life. I want to thank the rest of my family members. I see my aunt is here. I see my other aunt back there. And if there's anybody else that's here in the family and I didn't get to call you out, or I want to let you know that I love you and I appreciate your support. I won't prolong God's message any further. If you would all stand. And turn with me to Exodus, the second chapter. We will be reading verses 1 through 10, and it will be coming from the New King James Version. And at this point in Exodus, we will be talking about the birth of Moses. And it reads, "And a man of the house of Levi went and took as wife, a daughter of Levi. So the woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a beautiful child, she hid him 3 months. But when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him, dabbed it with asphalt and pitch, put the child in it, and laid it in the reeds by the river's bank. And his sister stood afar off to know what would be done to him. Then the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river. And her maidens walked around the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the reeds, she went her she sent her maid to get it. And when she opened it, she saw the child. And behold, the baby wept. So she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrew children." Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women that she may nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." So the maiden went and called the child's mother. Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you wages." So the woman took the child and nursed him. And the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. So she called his name Moses, saying, "Because I drew him out of the water." You may all be seated. Can we all bow for a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, I come to you this evening as humble as I know how, giving you all the praise, all the worship, thanking you, God, for your anointing, thanking you, God, for your power, thanking you, God, because you first loved me. Now, Lord, decrease me and increase you inside of me. Let your spirit fall like fresh rain, and let your word go forth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The topic of my sermon is, "He shall hide me." The statement, "He shall hide me," is a bold choice of words with a prophetic undertone. This choice of words denotes to the deliverer that in time of trouble, I can count on God to cover me. I can count on him to conceal me, and I know that God is with me. But sometimes the people of God need to be reminded God will intervene on your behalf, and God will deliver you. Being a child of God does not exempt us from hardship and trials. One thing that we can surely stand on is that God will protect us. When you look at the life of Moses, you can see the protection of God over his life at an early age. The first sign of protection was the basket. God took a basket, y'all, and placed a baby in it, gave his mother the wisdom, gave her the courage she needed, because that took courage to put your baby in a basket and you don't even know if you'll see him again. But she had faith in God, and that faith in God helped her to put some stuff on the basket, things on the basket that would protect that basket and that would protect that baby as he went down the Nile. Another thing that God will use are people. Now, God used the mother to put the baby, to get the basket rolling, so to speak. And then he used his sister. Now, sisters protect you. And this particular sister, instead of going on about her brother was good, that he was not going to be harmed. And then we see what God uses Pharaoh's daughter. Now, the baby started crying once the basket reached her. And it was that cry. Only a baby's cry, for some of us, we know what that's like. Mothers, you know what that's like to hear a baby's cry. That baby's cry touched her. God can remove people, places, and things also. People that are out to hurt you, places and things that can hinder you from your purpose for your life. Shout protection. Protection. God will protect me. Psalms 46 and 1 also states that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Sometimes God protects us. When God protects us, we find ourselves needing him to intervene on our behalf. In the text, God intervenes by giving his parents time to hide him for 3 months. Now that word three, it just rings out for me. Because when we think about the number three and the significance of it, we think about the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We all need the Holy Trinity. We all need the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that brings me to my point that it was God that told them, that gave that mother the idea of what to do. God has perfect timing. Never early, never too late. We just have to have patience and it takes a lot of faith. Our lives burden us down and gets us down and takes us away from the path. But we have to remember to pray. Prayer is a tool that gets us close to God. We've been talking about prayer on Wednesday nights, how it's an instrument and it's necessary for our relationships with God. We all should pray. This world is wicked. There are things going on that we would have never thought we would never seen. You could have never. He intervenes. And look at us today. We're all here. We all are gathered for a joyous occasion where the women of God are called to give the word of God, to spread the news. During the waiting season in our life, when God is intervening, he tells us to be patient. Be study to show yourself approved. We need to study the word. We need to cry out to God sometimes. We need to fall on our face and give ourselves to God. Because guess what? He's not governed by time. He is Alpha and he is Omega. He is the beginning and he is the end. He also can use our enemies on his behalf. Time when Hebrews were being persecuted. Now, I thought about that this week, and I remembered the incident on the television with the young man in Alabama, y'all. That hurt me to see a person, and it's not so much that he was African-American, but that he was being beaten for no reason, for simply doing his job. But this is the type of world we live in. When I tell you we need to pray, humble ourselves, move according to the will of God, we do. But you can also remember that God will intervene, and he did. The river could have been alligators in the water. When we are here to help one another, we're going to help one another. And that's exactly what God was showing us. We won't be oppressed anymore. That was what was going on in Egypt. The Hebrews were being oppressed. Pharaoh was doing evil things. He was doing ungodly things. But God intervened. God, that was a circumstance that God intervened on the behalf of Moses. Look at your neighbor and say, what's your circumstance? Is it drugs? Past relationships? Drinking? Depression? Whatever your circumstance is, there is a word for it. Romans 8:38 says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Another instance when circumstances come into play is when the favor of God covering Moses' mother when she is paid to nurse and take care of her own child. Now, help me if I'm not wrong. Did that strike you? Now, here you are putting your baby in a basket to go down this huge river, uncertainties of what's going to happen, and your daughter wants you to nurse this baby. Now, ain't God good? Ain't God good? When I tell you he'll intervene for you, I promise you he will. God is good, and his mercies endureth for all generations. So he went before her and made a way that she would be the one to nick. When you thought you got fired from that job only to receive a blessing, and now you have a new career with a better salary, we can praise God for that, because guess what? You thought it was all over, but God said, I meant what the devil meant for your bad, I meant it for your good. This was God interceding on our behalf. Just as God uses certain loves you. He will deliver you because he loves you, and he delivered Pharaoh's daughter. God placed Pharaoh's daughter at the right place at the right time. While she was bathing, minding her business, being a princess, because I'm sure she was, bathing and you know how we just, I like to take bubble baths, so I just get caught all up, and you know you want to let your stress out, and you don't knock on that door, don't bother me, let me just stay right here. And I hear a melody, knock, knock, knock. So she was bathing and relaxing and taking in the scenery, I'm sure. She then sends her maiden to get this basket. God loves his people so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That's found in John 3:16. Look at your neighbor and say, do you believe? He will deliver you because of his purpose for your life. We must remember that God is sovereign. Now, what does that mean? I'll tell you what that means. He can do what he wants, when he wants. Romans 8:28 tells us, and now that for those that love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. We can also witness, I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, do all things. As I thought about all of this, y'all, I thought about all of the different trials that I have gone through this week. Pastor taught us that when God has something for you to do, Satan will get busy. He got busy trying to separate me and my family. First, my son. I have never been away from my son more than a couple of days. And when I tell you the fact that he's gone and I can't hear from him, that it caused a stirring in my spirit. And then the issue with problems that just come up. The devil is busy trying to separate families, trying to keep families apart. But this is a good lesson on how family sticks together. Miriam, she followed that basket because she loved her brother. So she stuck with her family. She made sure that baby was well taken care of. God blessed that baby where he would become a deliverer. And I'm reminded of the deliverer for us all. God sent his only son. Think about that. His only son. Bubba's my only son. God loved us so that he sent his only son to die for our sins. Here we are sinning, and Christ knew no sin. He died a horrific death. Every time I hear the story about his death, something new is brought to my spirit, and I just quiver even more. But then I think about his grace, and I think about his purpose, and I think about how God hid him from Herod, because Herod also was trying to take him out. That's another instance in the Bible when men fear for whatever reason. Their place is being challenged. Their kingdom's being challenged. But God sent a son, the S-O-N, and he shines S-U-N. He shines bright, and we can say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, God, for your sacrifice. And as I closed, I started thinking about my mom. Because she used to sing a song long time ago, way back in Cedar Grove. And it started off like this. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadow's grass, and he leads me beside the quiet streams. He restores my failing hand, and he helps me to do what I love the most. That's why I'm saved. That's why I'm saved. That's why I'm saved in his arms. Thank you.
I wonder, is there anybody in here God hid you? He hid you from the devil's plans. He hid you from the devil's schemes. He hid you. Glory be to God. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, he ain't hiding me no more. Glory be to God. It's your season. It's your time. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Wow. Wow. I remember Minister Douglas used to sing that song, Glory Be to God. Wasn't a dry eye in the place. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Sister Minor. Amen. For blessing our heart. Our last, for tonight, our last speaker comes to us from Connecticut by way of West Texas. Glory be to God. This young lady, and I'm going to say this, this young lady, you're going to find out she is one of the great minds of the kingdom. God has really blessed her. God has, she's probably read 500 books at least. Amen. But she has a hunger for knowledge. She has a hunger to know and to be equipped. And I thank God for her, because in her dwells a tenacity that if I was the devil, I might just step back from her. Amen. But God is doing a great work in her life. My brothers and sisters, I want to introduce to you Sister Latasha Scott.
There were times when I was going through, in the midst of my storms, didn't know what to do. Even though I was down, the Lord taught me to realize that I never would have made it without you in my life. No, I never would have made it without you in my life. There were times when I was going through, in the midst of my storms, didn't know what to do. Even though I was down, the Lord taught me to realize that I never would have made it without you in my life. No, I never would have made it without you in my life.
If it had not been for the Lord that was on your side, you never would have made it through every trial and every storm. Hallelujah. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. First, I want to give honor to God, who I love with all my heart and all my soul. I want to give honor to the most beautifulest people on this side of Texas, Pastor Ross and First Lady Ross. Ain't they fly, y'all? Amen. I want to give honor to any pastors and ministers in the building, to my husband, who I love, who I affectionately call Mister. He's right over there, y'all. That's right here. That's right here, right there, right there. Right there. To my children, to my best friend and my god baby and her sisters, and then a special honor to my uncle, who I call Big Leon, but to y'all is Pastor Fogle. Amen. All the way from North Carolina. Amen. He raised me, took me in. He's more than an uncle. He's a father to me. Amen. Let us stand and just pray. Speak, Lord. Speak like only you know how, Lord. Let them feed on what I fed on myself, Lord. Set food before them, Father God, from the pantry of your storeroom, Father God. And we give you all the praise and glory. Let's dive into this text. I'll be coming to from Psalms 121, the Christian Standard Bible. Amen. The Bible says, I lift my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. Your protector will not slumber. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not slumber or sleep. The Lord protects you. The Lord is a shelter right by your side. The sun will not strike you by day or the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. The Lord will protect your coming and going, both now and forever. Amen. Y'all may take your seats. I will use as a title, the Lord our helper. Life is a journey, and life is filled with ups and downs. We experience the joys of relationships, new job opportunities, getting married, having children, eating good, traveling good, seeing people graduate, people walking in the Lord. Amen. We also would deal with some of the most painful situations and experiences that can rock us to the core and have us feeling depleted, heartbroken, overwhelmed, hopeless, and in despair. Some have dealt with rejection from a spouse. Some have dealt with sexual abuse. Some have dealt with a loss of a child or a mother. People have shamed us that we called friends. Dealt with diagnoses of all type of sickness. As some say, as the great theologian Adrian Halliburton, life be life. Life is a journey, and we need help from our God, which brings us to our text. Psalms 121 is filled with the imagery of one who is on a journey. Life is a journey, and we cannot make it without dependency and help from God. Psalms 121 is part of 15 psalms, which called the Songs of Ascents. These songs in the Hebrew is a malah, and it means upward, and an upward move. It means to go up. And of songs which 14 and 17, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Heart, the Feast of Ingathering, depends if you like the King James Version, it says the Feast of Tabernacle or the Feast of Booths. Amen. And these was joyous occasions on their from their exodus from Egypt to the Promised Land. Psalms 121 was sung to build up their faith on the journey of earth. So we see in this text that the Lord is the source of our help. He said, I lift my eyes toward the mountains. The psalmster looks to the mountains seeking the source of his help. The psalmster knew that there was natural protection from the mountains. This journey wasn't easy. They didn't have the Jordans on and the Air Max ones while they was traveling from the valley to the mountain. They didn't have the Rolls Royce or the Honda Accord as they was going up to the mountains. They had dangers. Amen. And they understood that he was left for dead. Therefore, on this journey as believers, we cannot be complacent and thinking because we are saved and God is our Father, that we are not going to be, that we're not going to face trouble on this journey. The Bible says in this world you'll have trouble, but be of good cheer because I have overcame the world. Ability to sustain us. I'm not saying you do not pursue opportunities to give you more financial stability, education, asking Junebug and Ray Ray for help. But what I'm saying, all those things are only a means to help, not our source of help. Amen. The psalmster knew God is the only true source of our help. Psalms 46:1 says, God is our refuge and our all the wrong places. Solving problems in our own strength according to the wisdom of this world leaves us subject to fail and leaves us empty. Maybe you look to a relationship or a spouse to satisfy the longing in your. Maybe you look to the doctor to give you the answers to your unresolved health issues and they couldn't give you one. Maybe you look to your financial stability to give you long-awaited security, but you still feel insecure. Amen. We medicated ourselves in the week and the pain is still hurting us. We're not numb to it. We listen to Vlad TV, The Breakfast Club, $1 million worth of games, Stephen A. Smith, ESPN, even Kevin Samuel. And we was afflicted and aged. We were completely overwhelmed behind our strength so that we even the spirit of life itself. All those things are subject to fail you and have you discouraged. Amen. Then we see, he said, where will my help come from? We have to have a remembering moment. And a testimony to every believer, because knowing that our help comes from the Lord should give us confidence. There's a saying that God helps those who help us. That's a lie. That's not even biblical. It came from Benjamin Franklin, Poor Richard's Almanac. I like what H.B. Charles said pertaining to help. He says, self-sufficiency disqualifies you from divine help. You must confess that you need help and that you are helpless. The word help, those you cannot overcome on your own. The one who has the power to create heavens and earth also has the power to provide any help needed. The same power, amen, that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. We need the God kind of help. I remember when I was homeless, and I remember when I was going through a divorce, and I remember when my mother passed away and the heaviness on my life, and I didn't know what to do. I walked around mad. I walked around angry, and one day it was so heavy, I just cried out to God and said, help me, Lord. I need your help. And your testimony, your situation might not be my situation, but you have lost something. If it was opportunities. Isaiah 41:10 is, and the amazing thing about it is God wants to help us. Amen. He said, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous other things to help you and help us, and made them our functional saviors, and our lives were almost destroyed because of them. For every trying situation, he has helped. In trouble, he has helped you. When you were discouraged, he has helped you. When you were tormented in your fears, he helped you. When the load seemed heavy, he helped you. When sickness and disease, when you was raped or molested, people said all crazy things to you, he helped you. And he helped you when you was dead in your trespasses and sin. He set you free. Whatever you have been delivered from, whatever he took you out of, you should give him praise because he helped you. Amen. He gave him courage to fight the lion, and then he was ready to fight Goliath. He helped him. The three Hebrew boys, when they was in the fire, he was right there. They came out unsinged, not smelling like smoke. He helped them. God is right there in our greatest time of need. I truly believe what Deuteronomy 31:6 says. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Because I'm reminded he did not just care about their physical needs, but he also cared about their spiritual and their physical needs. He didn't leave you to yourself, but he gave you the Holy Spirit. Amen. So that's why we could cry out Psalms 109:26. We serve a God who helps us, but we also serve a God who keeps us. Which brings us back to our sex. As he said, he will not allow your foot to slip. He said he will not allow your foot to slip. God will give you the spiritual stability to keep you. I like that illustration. And that's how it is. Anytime you want to pick up your feet, you got to pivot. Because you know his word for your circumstance. Every time I go through marriage problems, I pivot. Because I know what the word of God says for my marriage. Every time I want to go out and cut somebody out, I remember what he said about my mouth in James. He will keep you from death, blameless in great joy. He says, Psalms 37, he says, a person's steps, ooh, that's good, are established by the Lord, and he takes pleasure in his way. Then we see in this text that we should have confidence in the Lord's keeping because he never sleeps a slumber. You know how we sleep and somebody call us and we miss a call. And they be like, man, I've been calling you. Man, I was asleep, dog. What's up, man? But God never sleeps or slumbers. We have a God that sleep or he don't slumber because we have an enemy. And the Bible says that the adversary, the devil, prowls like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. But he can seek all he want because God don't sleep and he don't get slumber. He's not drowsy. He's watching the enemy trying to destroy you. But he'll raise up a standard right there in your life. We don't have a sleeping God. We look at 1 Kings 18 with Elijah. He said, what's your God sleeping? Nah, my God ain't sleeping. I serve an awesome God. He'll keep you when you want to have a mental breakdown. When you was almost heading to a divorce, he'll keep you. When you almost went with the drugs and the alcohol, when you almost went to that prison, man, he kept you. When COVID came and high prices came with gas and food and, man, HEB bills be so high now, but he's keeping you. When your balls get on that last nerve, he has kept you. He kept you when opportunities didn't come. He kept you when midlife crisis come. You know you shouldn't have bought that Corvette, but he kept you from doing it because he is the one that sustains you. He kept you from health issues. He kept you from depression and anxiety. How many people have God kept when dangers was all around? when life felt uncertain and hope is lost. He kept us by his power. He kept us by his love. He kept us by his faithfulness. All we have to remember our testimony, how he kept us from things seen and unseen. Oh, he keeps us, God. He's so good. He's so good. Then we see in the text from verses 3-8 how he protects us. The Lord will protect us. The Lord helps us by protecting us. The Lord is your shade, or I like how the King James verse, he said the shade on your right hand. The right hand symbolizes power and authority and favor and strength. When you see, you got to understand this journey, they were suffocated by the heat. But amen, we don't have to suffocate under the circumstances of life. Because life will happen to us, and sometimes it feels like it's choking us up. But he said who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. He said the sun will not strike you by day. When we're going to work, he will protect us when we're coming from work. He'll protect us when we get on that plane. He will protect us when it lands, God. He will protect our family. He will protect our children. He will protect our mother and them. God is a protector. And he will protect you from all harm, moral and physical. He protects your rod and your staff. They comfort me. Your God, you. And then I love what Psalm 73:24 said. He said, you guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will take me up to glory. So God is protecting you all the way up to glory. When you stand before the righteous judge, whatever is going on in your life, he is protecting you. He said in Romans 8:28, and we know that for those who love God, all things are working together for good. For those who are called according to his purposes, for those whom he foreknew, those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What a joy. What a joy. That the God we serve, he keeps us. Amen. He helps us, he keeps us, and he protects us. Our response to God should be thanksgiving, to pray and testify about the goodness of God and how he helped us and build someone else's faith up with our testimony. We should meditate and feast on his word. We should find promises in his word to hold on to when we are waiting on God. Life. It's not like a box journey. We are going to experience things that will cause wounds, and we need our God to help keep and protect us from the things that can make us throw in the towel. I'm reminded of the hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. He said, what a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path that grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. What am I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, safe and secure. God, you good, Lord. And I love you. And I pray, Father God, that your people will hear the word, Father God, and be transformed by the word, Father God. That they will go out and share the gospel with these lost, broken people. That they will share the gospel with the least and the last and the lost, God. People are out here, Father God, hurting and broken and traumatized, God. And we got the greatest news that don't be shared, God. What you have done through your son to save us, Father God. And I pray, Father God, that they understand and they know, God, that you are their help, God. That you are a keeper, God. And that you protect them, Father God. In Jesus' name, God, and we give you all the praise, and everyone say amen.
Amen. Did our souls not burn within from these four powerful preachers of the gospel? Give them a round of applause. Let them know that you love them. Support them. Give God a round of applause. Give him praise for what he has done through these four people. The words that have been spoken today have went out and they have blessed our... Let them know how much you love them right now. Amen. Now that we've heard the word of God, we're going to go a step higher. And this place where we go right now is one of the most important parts of any service that we could attend. And it's, we have the altar call, invitation to Christian discipleship. So at this time, our ministers have come. And if you at this time desire prayer, if you have a need to take your problems that have been holding you down all through the week, because we have all encountered circumstances and situations in our lives that tried to knock us off course, right now is the time that you could bring those problems and give them to Jesus. You've tried yourself. The message that she spoke about, the lady with the issue of blood, that she had tried all she could do. She knew that all she had to do was give it to Jesus. Now, these people, these ministers, our pastor, myself, we are not Jesus, but we know how to get you to him. And if you come forward right now, you can come and you can give your life over to Christ. You can come. You can receive prayer right now. The altar is open. The doors of the church is open. We're ready to pray for you. We're ready to cry with you. We're ready to just be with you as you come into the fold of Jesus Christ. But first, I want to do a prayer of redemption. Heavenly Father, we come thanking you right now, God. And Lord, those that are listening to my voice right now, I pray that as they pray with me, God, and repeat the words that I'm saying, God. Father, I have sinned, and I've fallen short of your glory, God. Your expectations and your guidelines depicted in the word that you set forth that was manifested a long time ago. And now, God, I come to the realization that everything that I thought I knew, I don't know. All the people I thought I knew, I didn't know. But God, I know one thing for sure, that you will never leave me nor forsake me. And God, I pray right now that you come in right now and forgive me of all my transgressions. Forgive me of all of my sins. Forgive me of all of my shortcomings, God. Take out all the trash that is within me right now and throw it out to be cast into the sea of forgetfulness, never to be revisited again, God. And bless me anew, God. Fill me with your presence, God. Fill me with your spirit, God. Cleanse me right now, for I believe that you are the Son of God, Jesus, that you lived, that you died, and that you rose again on the third day, and declared that all power of heaven and earth is in your hand, God. I believe you to be sitting at the right hand of the Father right now, making intercessions for me right now, for us right now, as we speak right now. So God, intercede, intervene on my behalf, our behalf, God, so that when it's all over said and done, God, we'll be able to enter into your kingdom and hear your voice say, well done, my good and faithful servant. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, you are saved. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it in your heart, you are saved. Our next call will be for those that are just looking for a church home. You know God, you've been saved, you know how to go to God whenever you've fallen short, but you don't have a church that you belong to. Well, I'd like to recommend a church. If you want to be fed spiritually, if you want an example lived before you by a pastor and by ministers that will be happy to show you the way to live, the way God wants you to live, and be successful in this journey that we call life, I recommend the Abundant Love Fellowship Church, where you will be taught to grow in the Word of God. Our next round will be, if you just desire prayer, come forward. Get it off your chest. Leave here better than you came. And if you, and I want to say this, if you do come, leave it at the altar. Don't take it back with you. Don't take it back with you. Doubt, leave it at the altar. Pain, leave it at the altar. Confusion, leave it at the altar. Hatred, you leave it at the altar. come heavy and leave light. It's ours to extend, yours to accept or reject, but never reject the hand of God. May God bless, may He keep you is our prayer. God bless you.
I was about to go on with the program, but God said, listen, I still got some stuff I want to do in this place. Oh my God, I need about three of y'all that's open to God right now. I need about three of y'all that's open to God. Open to His power, glory be to God. Open to healing and open. Oh my God, I feel breakthrough in the house. I feel breakthrough in the house, glory be to God. I dare about 15 of y'all to just lift your hands and say, give it to me now. Give it to me now, God. Give me now, God. I need your breakthrough. I need that breakthrough, Father. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. The devil is trying. The devil is trying to limit you. The devil is trying to limit your faith. And the devil is trying to limit your belief. But the Bible said all things are possible to him that believes. I need you to break through. I need you to break through that ceiling right now. I need you to break through that depression right now. I need you to break through that discouragement right now. And believe God. Believe God for everything in your life. Glory be to God. I dare you to say amen. I dare you. Amen means so let it be. Glory be to God. So let it be. So let it be. So let it be. If anybody can be healed, so let it be for me. So let it be for me. Come on, help us say, you are, you are, you are. Woo. Glory be to God. You are the source. Oh, I wish I had somebody in here. You are. Glory be to God. There's no limit in God. Hallelujah. Woo.
I lift my hands in total praise to you.
Listen, listen. Can I just lay this at your spiritual feet real quick? I promise we're going to move. Listen. How many of you know that you got to give God permission to interfere? I bet I had about 15 of y'all there. Listen, when you say God, when you lift your hands and you open your heart and you open your mind and you say, Lord, I need you now. What you have just done, if you has released God to work legally in your life, glory be to God. Can I tell about 15 of y'all, God wants to make a legal transition in your life. He wants to perform a legal transaction in your life. Well, what does that mean? That what is done in heaven will be done in your life. Oh, glory be to God. Make the exchange. Make the exchange. Glory be to God. The source of my life, the source of my strength. High five your name and say, if it was not for the Lord that was on my... Okay. Okay, we got to move. We got to move. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Let's seal it, Pharaoh. Come on. Amen. Come on, you seal it. You seal it. Hallelujah. So let it be. So let it be. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Healing is in my life. Amen. Glory be to God. Breakthrough is in my life. Amen. Hallelujah. Woo. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. God is telling somebody in here, if you let it go, he'll take it. If you let it go, God said, I'll take it. Oh, okay. I don't know who that's for, but the stuff you're holding on to was not by divine design. It was because of fear. It was because of intimidation. But God said, if you let it go, oh God. Oh, if you let it go, if you let it go, glory be to God. Oh, my God. Woo! to ask all of the ministers that preach for the first time to please come and stand before me. I'm going to ask all of the Abundant Love Fellowship ministers to come and stand behind them. All Abundant Love Fellowship ministers, please come and stand behind them. Hallelujah. Pastor, that's okay. We understand. That's okay, Pastor. Amen. If you're, amen. 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 Listen, I want ministers, please face me. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Minister Paul. Amen. Amen. Love them. Love them. Love them. Oh, we got to do war with them, y'all. Come on. Love them. Love them. For those of you who preach your first sermon, I want you to step forward just one step. 2 Timothy chapter 4. Paul gave Timothy a charge. And it's the same charge that I give to you. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Here's the charge. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. When your family don't want to hear you. When your friends don't come to hear you. Know that you don't preach for people. You preach to people. God has called you to do a work for him. He says, preach a word that reproves, that rebukes, that exhorts, and with all long suffering and doctrine, for the time will come, and is now, that they will not endure sound doctrine. Don't watch too many people on YouTube. God didn't call you to get likes. He called you to plant seeds to make disciples. The time will come that they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away from the truth and turn unto fables. But watch in all things. Ministry is not a walk in the park. You're going to be afflicted. You're going to be challenged. You're going to be criticized. You're going to be talked about. But endure afflictions. Do the work of the evangelist. And make full proof of your ministry. Ministers, please lay your hands on them. Father, these vessels that you have called into the kingdom for such a time as this stand before you now, God, having already stepped forward. As Isaiah said, Lord, here I am. Send me. Father, they have stepped forward. They have preached your word. And now, God, I pray for fresh anointing to fall upon them, Father God. From the crown of their head, strengthen them where they're weak, Father. And Father God, I pray in the name of Jesus, ignite a fire that the devil can't put out. Give them strength for the affliction. Give them resolve for the challenge, Father God. But Lord, never let them lose their love for you. And Father God, I speak blessing over them. I speak prosperity over them. I speak, Father God, the complete work of the Holy Spirit to be manifested in their lives. through every trial, through every storm, they will prevail. By your spirit and by your power, we decree it and we call it done. In Jesus' name, amen. Sister Mia, I give to you a certificate of license to preach the word of God. Sister Latasha, I give to you a certificate of license to preach the word of God. Sister Yolanda, I give to you a certificate of license to preach the word of God. Sister DeQuisha, I give to you a certificate of license to preach the word of God. God has called you on purpose, in purpose, for purpose. Fulfill. You don't retire from this. You don't vacation from this. And even when things are going crazy in your own life, he still gives you opportunity for this. So let God use you. Not just in the four wall church, but everywhere you go, let God have his way. God bless you. What you got. Look how much support you got. And just in this house, look how much support you got. Know that you're never alone. God has blessed you with support. Amen. Amen. Now I'm going to ask you four to remain. Thank you. Thank you, Abundant Love Fellowship team. Ministerial team, I'm sorry. Glory be to God. Now I'm going to, this team has some presentations that they want to give to you.
The ministerial team to stand one more time. Okay. Minister Mia. Okay. In I should have brought my glasses, sorry. In 1 Chronicles 12, verses 12 through 26, the word of God tells us that we are many members, but we're one body. It goes on to state that God has placed each member in his body, and he has placed gifts in that body as it pleases him. It further states that there is not one member that is more valuable than the other, and that we rejoice together and that we suffer together. Today you've taken, I chose that verse specifically because today, as you embark on this journey in this ministry, I want you to see this ministry team. You're going to be joining this team, and we want you to know that we value you individually. We value the gift that God has placed in you as you join this team, that we value that because we know that he placed that in you as it pleased him. And we want you to know that as you join this with your unique gift, that as it's valuable to him, it's valuable to us as your ministry team. As you join it with us coming into this, we want you to know that we're rejoicing with you today as you pushed and you made that step, this huge step coming into this. But not only do we rejoice with you, then the times that you need us as your ministry team, lean on us because we're here to take this journey with you wherever it goes with you. make sure that you lean on us as your ministry team, as you see all of us and you join with us. So I present to you this gift on behalf of this ministry team and also on behalf of the member partners of Abundant Love Fellowship.
God bless all of you. You are a blessing to us tonight. We're looking forward to watching you grow and watching God just have his way. And Sister Monty, Minister Monty, I want to give this to you tonight to let you know that you came from a family that's filled with the Holy Ghost. But y'all don't know, this is the Shouting Sisters from Chilton, Texas. Was her grandma and her auntie there. So just like it was in Lois and Eunice, I know it's in you. Thank you for blessing us.
Hello, ladies. God bless each and every one of you. I'm so proud of each of you all. To Sister Tasha. Y'all, Tasha tried to run from me when she first came to this church. She said I was weird. But that's okay. That's all right. That's all right. We have grown to love each other. We have grown to be on the phone laughing. She sends me things out of nowhere. So I just want you to know that I love you. I'm so proud of you. And on behalf of Abundant Love Fellowship Ministerial Team, we present this to you.
Thank you. Well, praise God. Each of these young ladies, believe it or not, have spoken life to me today. And not just today, but even before they preach their first sermon, in so many different ways, they've been such a blessing to all of us. And I'm here to present to Minister Daquisha Betters. Amen. Amen. I am just so elated. I was so blessed by the message. Just to be reminded that while God is taking care of your business, he's taking care of mine too. So you be blessed and continue to reach forward and see what the end is going to be. God has great and mighty things in store for you. God bless you, sweetheart.
On behalf of the Abundant Love Fellowship Church, we just want to bless you. Maybe some study material. Amen. Just want to help you in this journey, because God indeed called you to be a witness for him. This last presentation is from my wife and I, and we are so very godly proud of all four of you, and we thank God for you, and we look forward to doing ministry with you. Amen. Are there any other presentations? Anybody have any other gifts? Amen. 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 Where is Brother Chad? Come on up here. Come on up here. See, Brother Minor started something. Brother Minor, you stay up here. Glory be to God. Brother Scott, come on up here. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Come on. Y'all got some gifts. Let them have it. Let them have it. Amen. 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 Reverend Lee said, I don't want Quisha up there by herself. Let me go stand with her. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. This is a wonderful day, y'all. Boy, these brothers, they done took the game to another level. Glory be to God. Cherie, you got, that's what I'm talking about, Cherie. Amen. 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 Listen, listen, this is such a beautiful occasion, but I'm going to say, like when a team wins the Super Bowl, celebrate now, because we got some games to win. Amen. 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 Praise God. Now, sister. Now, Minister Scott, I'm sorry. Minister Scott, now you, is this the pastor? Leon Fogle? Pastor Fogle? Come on up here, man. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. There are no strangers in the kingdom, amen? Amen. Come on, put your hands together if Pastor Fogle comes.
Y'all better stay God, tell God thank you. You don't give a minister a microphone. Come on, give God some praise. Come on, give a little bit more praise. I am so proud. I'm proud of all of y'all becoming the 67th book of the Bible. You are God's last idea for redemption. Amen. You are the next warriors. Your ministering today is a blessing. Amen. There's angels getting ready to back up the message that y'all have. There's deliverance that's getting ready to happen through the mouth you're getting ready to speak to people. You're nothing but an agent of God. But this one here, this is my niece. This was my protege. This was the little girl that would steal my notes and amen at 7 years old, was asking God to use her, but was convicted at 7 years old. This is the one that would weather storms and then ask, what do I do? Even in Texas, and she told me about you, because I always ask, you know, that's my daughter. She's more than my niece. Her grandmother gave it to me to raise her. And I love that child. And I'm so proud of her. Her hunger started a long time ago. I got books missing in my house because she took them. I would tell my wife, I gotta work with her. I got other kids. But this one has the fire. And I'm thankful for that. And I'm so blessed to come. And I told her, I apologize for taking this long to come to Texas. And I live in North Carolina. But I'm a Yankee. I'm Connecticut. Don't get wrong. And she would just bring a lot of Bridgeport out of here tonight. She's just real. Don't get her wrong. She's just real like that. But she hurts and burdened for souls. And I thank God for all of y'all just welcome us here. And we won't be a stranger. I got to come visit more often. I thank God for a husband who just welcomed me, picked me up, and your lovely congregation.
Amen. Come on, give God praise. Hallelujah. Now listen, how many of you are of the Baptist persuasion? Got a history in the Baptist church? Well, you're going to understand what I'm about to say. We have a repass. Okay. For everybody else, refreshments are served in the back. Amen. Praise God. Please share with these great women of God. Amen. Isn't this beautiful? Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. Stand on your feet all over the building. I want to thank everybody, all of our ministers and our music ministry, amen, our lit ministry, amen, I want to thank everybody, amen, that had a part in this great occasion. Amen. Glory be to God. Father, we give you glory. We give you praise. And Father God, we thank you in advance for the great work that's going to come through these vessels. And Father God, as we leave this place this evening, Father God, we declare we never leave your presence. Be with us. Show yourself strong in our life, Father God. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and who presents us faultless before his throne with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be dominion, power, and glory henceforth, now, and forever. And Father God, we declare the food blessed. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.